I'm Paul Larson, and it's time to shine the spotlight on violin virtuoso Joshua Bell and his fantastic instrument. He plays a 300-year-old Stradivarius with a mysterious history. In 1936, the violin vanished from Carnegie Hall, and its adventures continue with its current owner, as you will hear. When we spoke at his home in New York City, the violinist entertained me with stories about his career and his incredible violin. The violin played by this performer has a fascinating history. It's a Stradivarius from the year 1713, worth millions. But its current owner once abandoned it among the truckers.
It was late at night after a concert at Tanglewood in Massachusetts, and the only place open after the concert was a truck stop, and I went there and ate. I was so exhausted. At 1 in the morning, I went home, got into bed, and thought, where is my violin? And I didn't remember where the truck stop was, so I actually got in my car, went in the direction where I thought it was, and finally actually waved down an 18-wheeler truck and asked him, where the heck is the truck stop? And then he pointed me in the right direction. I went there, and there was my violin sitting by the door. You know, I think every violinist has a few stories like that. I mean, I don't want it to sound totally irresponsible. It does happen every once in a while. But for the most part, I am extremely careful, and I keep it with me all the time.
Sometimes the drama in this musician's life plays itself out on stage.
There was one time with my bow, which this was about 20 years ago, and it was a borrowed bow, very expensive bow, and it was the second to last note of the piece was a big up bow, and I completely let go of the bow, and it went about 20 feet up in the air and fell behind me, and luckily the pianist just kind of held waiting for the last note, and I ran over, picked it up, and we played the last note together. Audience, of course, loved that sort of stuff, but I was crossing my fingers as I watched it fall that it didn't snap in two, and it was fine.
The man who's leaving his violin at a truck stop and losing his bow on stage is one of the world's most sought-after musicians. He sells out concerts, wins a Grammy, even appears in People magazine as one of the 50 most beautiful people in the world.
Well, the People magazine thing was just basically embarrassing. You know, my friends teased me about it, and I was the token classical musician on their list that year, and you have to take it for what it really is.
Who Joshua Bell really is a very modest violin virtuoso.
What is a virtuoso? I never really knew what that meant.
Bell began playing at the age of 4 in his hometown of Bloomington, Indiana.
At what age did you know you wanted to play the violin professionally?
I think I'd say it was around the age 12 that I realized that this was something I could do for a living.
At 14, he started appearing as a soloist with the world's great orchestras. Several international concerts, recordings, and awards later, in the late 1990s, French-Canadian director François Girard asked Bell to participate in a movie called The Red Violin.
I got very excited, and he said he'd like me to be the voice of the Red Violin.
The violinist worked closely with the film's music composer, John Corleone. Bell also appears on screen.
I was the body double of the film. I even have a little cameo in it. It was just an amazing project. I mean, a film like that about my instrument, you know, will come along maybe every couple of decades. And I was felt so fortunate to be part of this one.
The movie relates the intriguing adventures of one special instrument through the centuries. Bell's own violin has a sensational past, too.
The most famous story about this instrument was when it was stolen from Hubermann, the great violinist at the beginning of the 20th century. Actually, in 1936, Hubermann was playing on this instrument in Carnegie Hall, right, just 30 blocks up from here. And he had the violin in his dressing room, and it was just taken from the dressing room, disappeared, and poor Hubermann never saw the violin ever again. And no one knew where it was for 50 years. Turns out the thief had been had taken it for himself. He didn't try to sell it. He just wanted to play on a Stradivarius. And he played in cafes and gigs around New York on this Stradivarius for 50 years until on his deathbed, he finally admitted to stealing it.
Hubermann sits next to Albert Einstein in a picture on the wall of Bell's Manhattan penthouse. The renowned violin teacher Joseph Gingold gave his student many photographs and autographs when he passed on. The photos include three composers whose works appear on Bell's latest CD, Camille Saint-Saëns, César Franck, and Maurice Ravel.
There's Saint-Saëns, there's Franck, and there's Ravel, a program of Ravel. So it's fun to play the pieces. You know, I often catch myself practicing a piece of music and realize I'm sort of staring down at me as the composer, you know. But it adds another element of inspiration.
The CD celebrates romantic and impressionist French music.
I really grew up playing a lot of French music. My teacher, Gingold, was a student of Eugène Ysaÿe. Ysaÿe was sort of the consummate French-Belgian musician in Europe at the time, at the end of the 19th century and beginning of the 20th. And the whole French sort of school of playing, which involves a way of playing with a bow with a lot of nuance and color, which is the way I think of French music and French sort of school of playing, is something that my teacher really incorporated and stressed the beauty of the nuance of the French music. And now Franck and Saint-Saëns and Ravel, this is music that really speaks to me, and so I'm happy to have done this recording with Jeremy Dank, a long-term musical partner that is he's one of the great pianists now.
What is the state of classical music in the 21st century, and what has to happen in order for it to survive?
Well, I'm very encouraged by the state of classical music. I know there are many people saying it's dying, which is, if you look back historically, it really doesn't seem to be happening. We have more orchestras, professional orchestras, many more than there ever were, even, you know, a century ago, at the so-called heyday for classical music. We have so many kids, you know, hundreds of thousands of kids taking violin lessons and Suzuki lessons, and I see many of them coming to my concerts every day, and it gets me very encouraged that there's a future in classical music.
The violinist calls encouraging children to appreciate classical music a top priority. He often visits schools and music camps.
And I play something, and you copy me.
Well, it sounds great. Let's try it.
Okay, here goes.
Visiting a famous street made him a celebrity with the super young crowd.
Going on Sesame Street was something really cool for me. I grew up in around the birth of Sesame Street. In the early 70s, so being on the set was awesome. And then having my nieces at the time when I went on, you know, not even knowing that I was going to be on it, they were watching it at home in Indiana and said, Mommy, Uncle Josh is on Sesame Street. They got such a kick out of it, so I was kind of a hero for a while for that. But it was very special. Sesame Street is such a wonderful thing. I was lucky I had parents that just thought that music is part of your diet, like mathematics and learning to speak. And I feel that that should be like that for all kids. And so whatever I can do, I try my best to encourage, you know, people to support PBS, support their schools, and support the arts, because it's a sad society that doesn't have arts.
The musician's appearances with orchestras and recital tours take him away from his Manhattan home about 200 days a year. Playing the violin is work for Mr. Bell. He does other things for play.
Do you do any activities that might put your arm at risk or your fingers at risk?
You know, I do ski a little bit. I probably shouldn't ski at all because it is kind of not great for the arms if you fall. But I've always sort of taken the philosophy that you have to live. You know, if you live in fear, you're going to probably, you know, trip outside your own door and break your arm anyway. So even my very first recital when I was 12, the one that turned out to be the most important of my life, because Gingold came to that concert and took me on as a student because of that, I almost didn't play that concert because earlier in the day I'd been throwing my boomerang and it came back and it hit me in the chin. And I had to go to the hospital and get stitches. If it had been like 2 inches to the left, I probably wouldn't have been able to play at all. And who knows how my life would have changed.
Is there anything at all that you would still like to accomplish?
Well, the thing about being a classical musician is that it's endless, the things that one wants to do, and there's just not enough time to do it. And I'd like to do more composing, which I've dabbled in, but I would like to be more of a composer. That's the ultimate goal. But there's endless amount of repertoire for the violin. It's just, we'll see how much I can get through in my lifetime.
All right, Joshua Bell, you're okay on that thing.
That was fun.
The Sony Classical label has many works available from Joshua Bell, including the Red Violin soundtrack and the French Impressions album. The Nobel Prize concert featuring Joshua Bell is currently available on DVD and Blu-ray through Accentus Music. Spotlight is a production of Mountain Lake PBS. For more information about our productions, head to the website at mountainlake.org.